Tentor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Ordeal of the Mountain Man by William W. Johnstone, narrated by J. Rodney Turner. 1. Dust rose like a brown shroud around the rumps of a long string of shiny-coated horses as they trotted, tails high, away from the lush pastures of Sugarloaf, Smoke Jensen's ranch. Smoke and a dozen hands, including Utah Jack Grubbs, Jerry Harkness, and Luke Britton, had set out to drive a herd of 200 remounts north to Fort Custer on the Crow Indian Reservation in Montana. It would turn out to be a much longer and harder journey than Smoke would have believed, becoming a grueling ordeal for Jensen and every man with him. At the lower pasture fence, Sally and young Bobby Jensen set their mounts and waved at the departing backs. Sally thought uneasily of the many times Smoke had ridden away on far more dangerous missions. Over the nearly 10 years they had been married, after Smoke's first wife and sons were brutally murdered, Smoke had strapped on 6 guns and frequently a badge, and had gone off to right the wrongs done to himself, or more often to others, even strangers. Smoke didn't see himself as any sort of Robin Hood, though he had read the legends as a youth, learning from the old mountain man preacher what he had abandoned when he strayed from his parents' wagon as a half-grown child. The family had been bound for the Northwest Territory when he got lost in the wilderness. Sally had first seen Smoke Jensen as a ruffian, a barbarian, a gunfighter. She was teaching school at the time. Smoke came to town and cleaned out a gang of gun trash and saddle tramps, leaving a wide wake of bodies along the way. At first, his bloodthirsty conduct disgusted and frightened her. She had soon learned better when he rescued her from the clutches of the gang boss. After that, she knew him as a tall, handsome man with longish reddish-brown hair and a ready smile. Now she brushed aside such reflections and thought about the 3 hands who rode with him. Jerry Harkness had been with Smoke ever since he changed from cattle ranching to raising blood horses. Jerry knew more about horses and their ailments than most veterinarians. He had grown up on a thoroughbred farm in Kentucky. Lean and tall, Jerry was in his mid-20s with the bowed legs of a jockey, his muscles bunched and corded. He was, as their cook Zeke Thackeray put it, smack-bang loyal. Jerry rode for the brand and would die for it if need be. Another cut from the same mold was Luke Britton. A year or two younger than Jerry, he was an easygoing, even-tempered young man with a high school education, which was an exception for the times. Barrel-chested and broad-shouldered, he was frequently mistaken for a bare-knuckle boxer, which he wasn't, but he could hold his own, much to the regret of many a proddy drifter who challenged him. Luke was a man to ride the river with. Jack Grubbs was a short, bow-legged, salty horse expert with a checkered past. When the Sugarloaf foreman had interviewed him only 3 months earlier, he had been troubled enough by what he learned to turn Jack over to Smoke to question. Later, after he had hired Grubbs, Smoke told Sally that Jack had been in prison. A streak of wildness in his youth, Utah Jack had explained, which he had outgrown. Recalling his own past, Smoke had said that all Jack needed was a chance to redeem himself. For some reason, that now came back to give her a cold shiver along her spine. She shook it off and turned to their adopted son. "Come on, Bobby. We might as well ride back to the house. We won't see them for 2 months," she added with a sigh. How she would miss her beloved Smoke, she thought, as she brushed a lock of black hair back behind an ear. Bobby wrinkled his freckled pug nose and put words to her thoughts. "I'm gonna miss Smoke awfully," his 14-year-old's voice croaked with the awkwardness of change. "I hope nothing happens to them." With Luke and Utah Jack on swing, Pop Walker on drag, Smoke Jensen rode at the front of the trail herd with Jerry Harkness. They headed for Wyoming in a light-hearted mood. Jerry cracked a constant string of Indian and politician jokes. "Did you hear the one about the politician who went out to explain to the Sioux chiefs about the new treaty? He got out here with an interpreter who translated his words. After each sentence had been put in Lakota, the chiefs would grunt and say, 'Umkache.' He told them how they would be restricted to reservations from now on, and again they said, 'Umkache.'" Smoke was surprised that Jerry pronounced the word correctly. "Umkache." "So this goes on until the end when the chiefs all tapped their open palms with their eagle wing fans and shouted it three times. Then one chief got up and made a short speech. The interpreter told the politician that the chiefs thanked him for his good words and wanted to know if he wished to see some of Sioux life. The politician said that yes, he did. He had always wanted to see a buffalo hunt. It was arranged, and hunters rode out to find the bison while the chief and the politician started walking out on the prairie where the buffalo roamed. All of a sudden, the interpreter reached out and grabbed the politician's arm and stopped him from stepping in a big pile of buffalo bullplop and said, 'Be careful not to step in the umkache.'" Smoke groaned and held his side. He had heard it before. "Jerry, don't you have anything better to amuse yourself?" "Oh, sure. Did you hear about the Indian, the settler, and the politician who all died and wound up outside the pearly gates?" "Spare me," Smoke wailed in mock agony. 4 days later, 6 pair of eyes watched while the herd crossed the border from Colorado into the Wyoming territory. One of the men in the small party, Yancey Osborne, turned to the others. "That's them, all right. Burke, you ride north and let Hub Boker know they're on the way." Ainsley Burke nodded, then asked, "What are the rest of you gonna do?" Osborne pointed to the sleek remounts. "We'll file along, send back reports on their movement." "Good enough. I'll tell Mr. Boker that." Burke walked his horse away from his companions in order not to draw the attention of the drovers. Once out of earshot, Yancey turned to the others with a nasty grin. "Well, boys, now that we've got Mr. Rulebook out of our hair, I've got me an idea how to pass our time while those nags move north." "What's that?" 2 chorused. Yancey gave them a wide wink. "I know of a nice little stagecoach we can rob." 50 miles northwest, Owen Curtis sat in his saddle, his left leg cocked up around the pommel, eyes fixed on the brown humps of his prize Herefords. He had paid a pretty penny for the first bull and 3 cows that formed the base of his herd. Over the years, he had added new blood, and his stock increased by nature's decree. Although the bevy was still small, Owen modestly counted himself as a rich man. By the lights of many who struggled against the hostilities of Wyoming Territory, the severe winter weather, summer drought, and, of course, always the Indians, Curtis was indeed a wealthy, successful man. The rumble of distant hooves drew his attention to the head of the grazing beefs. 3 of his hands kept them in a loose gather, allowing them to move slowly through the grassy meadow, eating their fill, while subtly leading them toward water. 7 riders appeared abruptly over the ridge of the basin, riding hard toward the cattle. Owen Curtis looked on helplessly, stunned by the sight, as puffs of white smoke blossomed from the muzzles of the rifles the intruders held to their shoulders. 2 of his men went down as Owen swung his leg into the stirrup and slid his Winchester from its scabbard. More gunshots crackled through the basin, and the cattle bolted and began to run wildly across the meadow. A 6 more rustlers jolted down the side slopes of the bow-like pasture and began to turn the cattle back on their frightened fellows. Curtis took aim and knocked one outlaw from his saddle with a bullet through the chest. He worked the lever action of the Model 73 and sought another target. The only problem was that he had attracted the attention of the thieves. 3 cut their horses in his direction and bore down on the rancher. 1 of them raised a rifle and fired. A bright hot pain erupted in Owen Curtis's chest. Debilitating numbness swiftly followed. Owen groaned and tried to line up his sights on the man who had shot him. The other 2 fired then, and he dimly heard a bullet crack past his head. Sheer whiteness washed through his skull an instant later, and he sagged in the saddle, lost his grip with his knees, and slid to the ground. Immediately, Hubble Voker snapped an order.
Get these snuffies under control and take them out of here.
Where to, Mr. Voker?
Take them up to Bent Rock Canyon, Garth. There's plenty pines up there to build a holding corral.
Garth Evans reacted predictably at once.
You mean work? Get blisters on our hands.
Hubble Voker laughed.
Ain't what you had in mind when you joined the Reno Gym Gang, is it?
Well, when you're counting your share of the take, you'll forget the broke blisters and sore muscles. He turned and shouted across the rumble of hooves to the others.
Get them under control. Head them up and slow them down.
With an anticipatory twinkle in his eye, Yancey Osborne watched the steady approach of the stage to Laramie. The heads of the six-up team bobbed rhythmically, and their powerful shoulders churned to draw the heavy-laden vehicle forward. It had taken Osborne and his cohorts a day's ride to get in position. Yancey figured the herd of remounts would stay to the main trail, there being plenty of Indians roaming out there if they did not. Now they were about to relieve the Wells Fargo Company of a good deal of loot. Osborne made curt gestures, directing his men to position. He and smiling Dave Winters remained in the center of the road, a fleshy barricade. The coach disappeared into a dip, and each of the outlaws raised a bandana to cover his face. Weapons at the ready, they waited for the stage to reappear a scant 30 yards from them. Pounding hooves, a jingle of harness, and the creak of leather springs announced the arrival of the Laramie stage. The heads of the lead pair surged above the draw and gained the level. Quickly, the rest appeared, and Yancey made out the driver and shotgun guard. He raised his Winchester and killed the guard before the driver could react to their presence in the road. With only his six-gun for defense, the grizzled teamster hauled on the reins and applied the brake. The coach swayed to a dusty stop. Immediately, the masked outlaws moved in. Ansel Wharton had driven stages for Wells Fargo for 9 years. In that time, he had been robbed 11 times. He knew exactly what to do when he saw the masked bandits strung out along the road and blocking it ahead, especially when the shotgun guard jolted backward and toppled over the side of the driver's seat. Meekly, all the while fuming inside, he hauled on the reins and brought the coach to a stop. The masked ones, like these, rarely killed everyone, he consoled himself.
Afternoon, called the big one in the middle of the road,
and Ansel could tell the sneer that had to be under the bandana by the tone of voice.
We'll relieve you of the strong box, if you please. What if I told you we don't have one?
He had to do that, company orders. The bullet-headed outlaw in charge shook his head.
Then your wife would be a widow. Ain't got a wife. She died of the cholera back a ways. Now, let me see. Was it in 64 or 72?
Anger rang in the snarled response.
Quit stalling and hand it over.
Facing defeat and knowing it, Ansel shrugged.
I'd be obliged if you let me step down and you had a couple of your friends remove it. It's a heavy sucker this trip.
Instantly, the outlaw's mood changed. He laughed delightedly.
Mighty nice to hear. Good enough, old man. Climb on down. Mind keep your hand clear of that hog leg you're packing. Oh, I've been robbed before, and I know what to do. Otherwise, I wouldn't be here. There's some of you do learn, I do declare.
The jovial bandit, Ansel named him mentally. He'd remember the voice. The size, too. This one was a brute. A huge bruiser with broad shoulders, a hefty girth, thick arms and wrists. Looked like he could take on 3 men at once and not raise a sweat. He worked his way down the small, round, cast-iron mounting steps and walked to the head stall of the lead horse.
Keep 'em from spooking, don't you see?
He explained to the highwayman. Yancey Osborne raised a ham hand to the brim of his hat and pushed it back.
Now there's a smart man. Good idea.
Keep 'em calm while we relieve you of everything else and ask the passengers for a contribution. Hansel hastened to give advice. There ain't but one strong box. He carefully omitted the shipment of gold bars under the backward-facing bench seat inside.
All right, everybody out of the coach. We forgot to bring any fancy steps, so you'll have to jump down.
An angry voice of defiance came from an imprudent drummer inside the coach. You're not going to get away with this. His sample case cost a fortune, and he had no intention of losing it. His pudgy hand darted inside his pinstripe suit coat and came out with a nickel-plated Baby Smith 38. Hastily, he fired a shot that grazed the shoulder of one of the outlaws to the side of the coach. A roar of gunfire immediately answered him. Riddled by 5 bullets, the salesman slumped back in the leather of the seat and bled all over the coach and other passengers. 2 women began to shriek and hug one another. Unfazed by the disturbance, Yancey Osborne motioned to the door again with his rifle barrel. Everyone out. In short time, the passengers had been relieved of their valuables and herded back inside the vehicle. Osborne set 2 men to unharnessing the horses. Before they left, the outlaws scattered the team. Galloping off with their considerable loot, the gold undiscovered, they cast not a glance at the stranded occupants of the stage.
We'll have to hunt down them horses, Ansel told the 2 male passengers. One of you stay with the ladies and see that they're all right. This is going to be a long day, he predicted with considerable accuracy.
Reno Jim Urian looked down from a long slope that formed one wall of a box gorge known as Bentrock Canyon. A satisfied smile formed under the pencil-lined black mustache that adorned his thin upper lip. Not a sign of the stolen cattle could be seen. His flat gray eyes took on an inner glow. We can keep them here until we have the horses as well. Then take them all in to sell. There's a livestock broker I know who doesn't look too close at brands.
You mean your partner, Mr. Kell?
At an upraised hand from Jim Urian, the not-too-bright Hubble Boker cut off his words before saying the name. Always the dapper dresser, Reno Jim preferred red silk-lined black morning coats with matching trousers, brocaded vests, and frilly white shirts, with spills of lace at front, collar, and cuff. He adjusted the latter now as he stared down his talkative second-in-command from under the wide brim of the flat-crowned black Stetson he habitually wore cocked at a rakish angle. Never mind who. The point is, he will buy anything we bring him. I want you to take over here for now and wait for word on the horses. I'm going on up to Muddy Gap to see that everything is ready for their arrival. Another branch of the Reno Jim Urian gang had grown bored waiting for the fabled horse herd to come to them. Like Yancey Osborne's men, they chose to engage in some casual criminal activity to pass the time. The Bighorn and Laramie line coach to Muddy Gap lumbered right up to them before the shotgun guard realized they had ridden into trouble.
Stand and deliver,
demanded a swaggering barrel-shaped highwayman with a gaudy ostrich plume in his floppy chocolate-brown hat.
Like hell, roared Roop, the shotgun guard, as he brought down his 10-gauge L.C. Smith and let go a load of double-aught buckshot.
His shot column took the hat from the arrogant bandit and pulped his face with 13 of the 17 pellets. Immediately, 3 of the holdup men leveled their 6 guns and slip-thumbed through a trio of rounds each, which shot Roop to dull rags. Beside him, the driver slapped the wheeler's rumps with his reins to no avail as he took one of the shots intended for Roop in his left forearm. Muscles and tendons, strong and rangy from years of working a 6-horse team, contracted and drove the broken ulna bone out of the driver's arm. He yowled and sat helplessly while 2 robbers caught the headstalls of the leaders and stopped the coach.
Everybody out. Show us what you've got.
A cawing voice of censure came from inside the coach.
Young man, that's a disgusting, vulgar thought. Shame on you.
Laughing outlaws surrounded the vehicle.
You must have been at school, marm. Am I right?
Guffawing,
A freckle-faced, red-headed bandit touched the brim of his hat to the descending dowager.
It's been my experience that schoolmarms are most familiar with that famous challenge of the youngins, ma'am. You know, you show me yours and I'll show you mine. It was a lot of fun doing that, as I recollect.
Examining him with cold blue marble eyes from above jowls made enormous by excessive snowy facial powder and carmine rouge, she snapped in tightly controlled outrage.
You are a most disagreeable young man.
I reckon I am. After all, I do rob stages for a living. Hardly a recommend to the better elements of society. Am I right?
Looking as though she might faint dead away, she fanned herself with a black-gloved hand.
Spare me from such depraved trash.
Anger flushed what could be seen of the outlaw's face.
I ain't trash. You get that straight, you old bat.
To emphasize what he had said, the red-headed bandit stepped in close and popped her in the chops. That proved too much for one of the male passengers. He leaped forward and drove a hard right into the gut of the impudent thug, who bent double and gasped for air. The defender of womanhood followed with a clout behind the ear, which dropped the young highwayman at the feet of the woman he had assaulted. Immediately a shot cracked over the heads of the passengers, and the would-be rescuer fell dead on the spot. Sobbing, the woman turned away. The bandits worked quickly after that. They relieved the passengers of all valuables and took the strongbox, missing the shipment of bullion the stage carried. Like the Wells Fargo team, the horses were run off when the highwaymen left.
2.
A thin, white spiral of smoke came from the chimney of the Iron Kettle, the best eatery in Muddy Gap, Wyoming territory. That it was the only public eating house in town, outside the hotel, the proud city fathers preferred not to acknowledge. Along the ambitiously wide main street, several prosperous business establishments had hung out their shingles. The raw wooden side walls and fresh paint of the building facades testified to the newness of this thriving community. Among them were Harbinson's General Mercantile, the Territorial Bank of Muddy Gap, the only stone building in town, Walker's Saddlery, Hope's Apothecary and Sundries, Thelma Blackman's Ladies' Fashions, T. Meyer's Butcher Shop, a blacksmith, the feed and grain store, and four saloons. At the north end of town stood a small, white, clapboard church. To the south, an equally minuscule schoolhouse. Inside the school, class had been in session since 8 that morning. The younger students, with the shorter attention spans, had become restless, eager for recess. The older grades, 3 through 8, laboriously attacked their assignments. Virginia Parkins, the schoolteacher, was listening to the 6th grade read aloud when the door slammed open against the inner wall and 3 large, loutish youths swaggered inside. Although she had 2 14-year-olds and 1 15 in the 7th and 8th grades, Virginia recognized these ruffians as being considerably older, the youngest not under 16. She looked on them with a frown of irritation. With expressions of blended contempt and disgust, the bullies strutted up the aisle and stopped beside the desk of young James Finch. One of them, a pig-faced boy named Brandon Kelso, spoke from the advantage of his height.
Get out of that desk, Jimmy. You ain't got no business wasting your time here.
11-year-old Jimmy Finch cut his eyes away from the imposing figure standing over him. He swallowed hard and spoke in a near whisper.
I gotta read next. What's that?
Brandon reached down with a large hand and yanked the slight, big-eyed boy out of his desk.
Your daddy needs you to help work stock. Now get your butt out of this dump and do as you're told.
Beside Brandon, Willie Finch, Jimmy's older brother, sniggered.
That's right, Jimmy Wimmy. Pa sent me to fetch you. Get your skinny little ass moving.
Thoroughly frightened, the small boy started moving his feet before Brandon Kelso lowered him to the floor. Outrage at this invasion overrode the usual quiet, non-aggressive demeanor of Virginia Parkins. She came to her feet so abruptly that her tall, backless stool toppled over and the book in her lap hit the floor with a loud bang. All eyes turned her way. Enough of your crude vulgarities, Brandon Kelso. You and these other louts need your mouths washed out with soap. Now, leave the children alone and get out of my classroom. Brandon took a cocky step toward her. Who's gonna make us, teacher? He sneered the last word. Fat, porcine lips curled in contempt. Brandon Kelso studied the outraged woman before him. She might make a good poke, he thought to himself, though he lacked any experience in such encounters. Couldn't be much older than himself. Those green eyes and the auburn hair, her wide, pouty-looking mouth, made his groin swell and ache just looking at her. Never thought she had any fire in her. He had quit school 4 years ago, before she had come here. He got tired of doing the sixth grade a third time at the age of 13. Now, if she had been here, he might not have quit. She would have given him something to fill his mind with when he was sitting in the outhouse. He made kissing motions with his lips. Her unexpected reaction surprised him. Virginia turned sharply away and walked directly to one corner by the blackboard. She came back with a stout willow switch about 4 feet long. Before its purpose registered on Brandon Kelso, she began to lay about the hips and thighs of the three bullies. The limber switch made a nasty whir and sharp smack with each stroke. When they all joined in a yelping chorus, she reached out and took the ear of the smallest in a firm grip and gave it a hard twist. Squealing, Danny Collins did a fancy dance step all the way to the door. Driving the others before her with the switch, Virginia hustled all three out onto the low stoop and hurried them down the steps. From the safety of the schoolyard, Brandon Kelso turned back to throw a final ominous taunt. You know my father's on the school board. If you want to keep your job, you better watch what you do to me and my friends. Fists on hips, she called after them. I'll risk that. Now get, and don't come back. That task completed, she returned to the schoolroom. Her expression calmed from its earlier outrage, she spoke in a soothing, quiet voice. You may return to your desk, Jimmy. You will read next. Riding his handsome, chestnut-roamed, thoroughbred stallion down the center of the main street of Muddy Gap, Reno Jim Urien sat tall in the saddle. He looked neither left nor right. With the schooled knees of a trained equestrian, he controlled his mount past the yapping of dogs, the shrill yells of children racing barefoot through the street, and the bustle and whirl of wagons, horsemen, and pedestrians. A light hand on the reins, he guided Walker's Kentucky Pride toward the tie rail in front of the territorial bank of Muddy Gap. There the well-mannered horse stopped primly on a dime and waited without even an ear twitch while Jim Urien dismounted. He looped the reins over the crossbar and removed his black leather gloves. Reno Jim used them to flick the spots of trail dust from his trouser legs and the sleeves of his immaculate swallowtail morning coat, then stepped regally up onto the boardwalk. Without a glance in the direction of the bank lobby, he walked to an extension of the plank sidewalk that ran along one side of the building into an alley. At its end, he began to ascend a flight of stairs that ended on a small platform outside a door that gave access to the second floor. Halfway down the well-scrubbed and highly polished hall, he paused a moment before the frosted glass pane that occupied the upper half of a closed door. Taking a deep breath, he reached out and turned the knob. He shouldered past the gilt-edged letters that spelled out in boldface, Boyne Kelso. Grain and livestock broker. He entered and flashed a winning smile at a willowy man in his early 20s, seated at the desk in the outer office. Good morning, Mr. Masters. Good morning, Mr. Urien. Mr. Kelso is expecting you. Go right in. Thank you. Robbie Masters looked after the visitor and sighed deeply. Oh, God, he's so handsome, he thought. Then he quickly busied himself with the stack of papers on his desk. Thus occupied, he did not see the sudden hard expression of contempt on the face of Jim Urien. Reno Jim opened the dividing panel and stepped into the sanctum of Boyne Kelso. I have good news, Boyne. When he closed the door securely behind him, he went on. That herd of remounts on their way to Fort Custer will soon be ours. Kelso revealed his surprise.
They really exist, then?
Yes, some of my men watched them cross over from Colorado. Just short of 3 weeks, they should be on the Crow Reservation. That is, they would be if we didn't have other plans for them.
Beaming, Kelso rubbed pudgy hands together.
Excellent, excellent. This calls for a mild celebration. I recommend the saloon bar in the Wilbur House Hotel. They pour a fine bourbon.
Reno Jim smiled back. That sounds fine to me. Together they left the office and strode out onto the main boardwalk. They talked of inconsequentials as they strolled toward the hotel. Every man who passed respectfully touched the brim of his hat in salute to Boyne Kelso. A woman in a wine gray, voluminous dress and white-edged bonnet of the same material nodded politely.
Afternoon, Deacon Kelso.
Good afternoon, Amanda.
Kelso responded grandly. Reno Jim smiled behind his hand. He knew that Kelso, born to a Protestant family in the north of Ireland, was considered a pillar of the community. Throughout Wyoming territory, his rectitude was legend. No one questioned his scales or the quality of seed grain he sold. Considered a loving husband and father with charming, well-mannered children, Kelso was frequently held up as a paragon of societal excellence. What would those fine, well-meaning people think if they knew the truth of Kelso's nature? Reno Jim mused. Most likely they'd fill their fancy drawers. Well, they needed those well-intentioned souls. Without them, they could never survive in the business of robbing and rustling. Nor could they profit any longer from the land swindles handled by their trusty underling in the land office. When the good folk lost their meekness, terrible things happened. He shivered when he recalled what had occurred recently in Cripple Creek. Somehow the good people of that area had found out they were being bilked, cheated, robbed, and even murdered by minions in the employ of Reno Jim Urien. They had organized a vigilance committee. He suppressed a shudder as he visualized 11 of his best men dangling from ropes over the limbs of brooding oak trees. So much gruesome fruit. And his own ignominious route from Cripple Creek, tarred, feathered, and slung over a pole. Reno Jim quickly banished the horrible visions as they reached the hotel. Inside, seated at a rich cherrywood table, Reno Jim eyed the softly glowing brass lamps and fittings, the dark, lustrous sheen of the mahogany bar, the muted nature of the flocked red velvet wallpaper, and sighed in contentment. This was the sort of world he preferred to live in. A coatless bartender, in sleeve garters and a blue pinstripe collarless shirt, brought them a crystal decanter of premium bourbon and two matching glasses. After he poured and departed, Kelso made quiet inquiry at Reno Jim. How soon will your men be coming here?
Sometime next week, certainly before the horses get here. I want to take them farther north.
Good. I'll be busy over the weekend with the church council. That brought a low chuckle from Reno Jim.
You had better keep your nose clean if you want to hold on to your fine reputation. But your plans are no problem. I'll also be busy over the weekend. They talked on for a while. During their third glass of the smoothest, sweetest bourbon Reno Jim had ever tasted, a sudden commotion rose in the street outside. Shouts to the effect the stage had been robbed brought both men to their boots. They shouldered their way through the room and out the bat wings into the lobby. A crowd had gathered in front of the Bighorn and Laramie stage line office by the time Boyne Kelso and Reno Jim Urien reached there. Men in overalls and flannel shirts, ranch hands in long-sleeved yoke shirts and jeans, merchants and their clerks in wool suit trousers, collarless shirts and aprons shouted questions.
How many of 'em was it, Sam?
Jaws at work on a cut of cut plug, the driver replied offhandedly.
Reckon there was nigh on to 10 of 'em.
Over their entreaties, Boyne Kelso spoke loudly.
How much did they get, Sam? The bank had a shipment on there, you know.
Conscious of the need for secrecy in transactions, especially of bullion, Sam glowered at the big broker.
Didn't touch that. Never mind, Mr. Kelso, that's between the company and the bank.
What's got me riled is that they killed Roop.
That's an outrage, Kelso thundered. I certainly hope your company has enough compassion to arrange for some church ladies to go along when his widow is given the news. And I say now that these depredations must cease.
To that end, I am offering a reward of $500, dead or alive, for those responsible.
Any idea who, Sam?
Sam shook his head. Nope, they all wore masks. Didn't give me a name like that Black Bart feller out in California a while back. Just took the money and these folks' valuables and rode off. We'd have been in sooner if they hadn't chased off our horses.
Kelso wrung his hands and cut his eyes from one man to another. This is deplorable. We cannot tolerate this any longer. Where's the sheriff? Why hasn't he sent out a posse?
He turned back to the coach. You folks who were on the stage, let me offer my condolences that this reprehensible deed was done so near to our fine community. If any of you are completely out of pocket, come see me. I have a grain and livestock brokerage above the bank. The name's Kelso.
With that, Kelso turned away and stalked toward the sheriff's office. Hiding his grin, Reno Jim Urien went the opposite way to retrieve his horse from in front of the bank. In 10 minutes, he rode clear of town, headed to meet his gang, and see what new profit had been gained in the holdup. Across the dividing ridge, Smoke Jensen decided the time was right to take care of what had been bothering him for the past day and a half. He reined in and motioned Jerry Harkness to take the herd on. He sat his new Palouse stallion, Cougar, while the remounts legged their way past. His face set in concentration, Smoke seemed not to notice the dust that boiled up. When Luke Britton, riding drag today, ambled by, Smoke gave him a light wave and dropped back down their trail. Near the crest of the ridge, he angled into a craggy gorge and reined up. 5 minutes later, 3 seedy-looking characters, whom Smoke had seen several times trailing them, walked their mounts into view. At once, Smoke rode out and confronted them, Cougar crosswise on the trail. Smoke kept his voice level as he addressed them.
I think it's time you fellas stopped trailing us.
Who says? The one in the middle challenged.
I do. Face suddenly flushed with anger. The proddy one spat at Smoke.
I don't cut no slack with me.
Smoke cut his eyes to each in turn.
Then I'll give you a choice. You can turn around and light a shuck out of here, or you can tell me why you're following us.
Through a sneer, the mouthy thug posed a question.
What if I said we was looking to hire on?
Shaking his head as though saddened, Smoke said,
then I'd have to call you a liar.
That does it, by God, that surely does it,
roared the aroused hard case as he dipped a hand swiftly toward his 6-gun. He had just cleared the cylinder of his Colt from leather when Smoke's 45 Peacemaker blasted the stillness of the rolling countryside. A slug spat from the muzzle and smacked solidly into the center of the chest of the saddle trash. His life shattered within him, the hard case reared sharply back against the cantle with enough force to snap the hat from his head. Then he went boneless and flopped onto the rump of his nervous dancing horse. By then, the other two had unlimbered their revolvers and now attempted to bring them up in line with this unnervingly fast stranger. They failed miserably in the attempt. Smoke's second round punched into the right side of the chest of the gunman nearest to him and shattered his shoulder blade. The thug's Smith American went flying in reflex to the pain that exploded in his body. His companion thought better of further aggression. He turned his horse, spurred it to a gallop, and sprinted for the top of the rise. As he disappeared over the crest, Smoke Jensen walked Cougar over close to the wounded man.
Now, tell me, who are you riding for?
Groaning, the trash looked up at Smoke through a haze of pain.
We ain't working for nobody. We only figured to cut out a few head and make a little money off them. That's all, mister.
Smoke's expression registered disappointment.
Why is it I don't believe you?
Well, in the event you all of a sudden remember who it is, you can tell him the reason you got shut up,
is that you ran into Smoke Jensen. His shock-pale skin went even whiter.
Oh, Jesus.
He can't help you. You ride on out of here while I pick up that six gun. We've got a herd to deliver. 3. A great bloated orange sun hung on the eastern horizon over Muddy Gap. The smoke from wood-burning cook stoves streamed from stovepipes. Shrill voices of children out to do their chores could be heard in the backyards of their homes. A small girl in a paisley dress called from the henyard,
"Chick, chick here, chick, chick, chick."
A boy, somewhat older than she, could be heard in a low barn,
"Sue, bossy, hold still, I gotta milk you."
From a spanking new carriage house, another boy announced cheerily,
"Here's your oats, Prince."
On a hillside overlooking the town, Hubble Voker sat his mount at the center of a crescent formed by the Urian gang. Together, they gazed down on the scene of domesticity. Voker waved a hand in the direction of Muddy Gap.
"We'll give him a little more time, let the shops open up in the bank. Then we make her move."
"Too bad the boss couldn't come along. He'd have enjoyed this."
Harry Joe spoke over the rumble of his stomach.
"I smell biscuits baking. Sure could use some of them."
Voker gave him an amused look.
"Maybe you can help yourself to some when we clean out the town."
Pleading sounded in Joe's voice.
"But I'm hungry now. What we gonna eat?"
"Air, if you didn't bring something along," Voker told him with a snort.
"Me, I've got me some cornbread from last night and some fried fatback. Sure gonna taste good.
You gotta plan ahead, Harry Joe."
Harry Joe appealed to a generosity that did not exist.
"At least let me have shares in some of that hub."
"Nope, ain't got enough. Ask the other boys. They only brung enough for theyselves, too."
Scowling, Harry Joe subsided. He cut envy-filled eyes to the rest of the gang while they munched on their leftovers. Unappeased, his stomach continued to growl. For solace, he rolled a quirly and puffed it to life. The smoke wreathed his head. 2 hours later, the main street began to bustle with merchants and their employees. Doors opened and shades went up. A few early customers rolled into town on buckboards or on horseback. Hubble Voker looked on, weighing the right time. It would not be long. That much he knew. Riding in twos as directed by Urian's second-in-command, the gang entered the main street of Muddy Gap from different directions. Each pair went to an assigned business front. Hub Voker and Garth Evans entered the bank. One teller looked up and peered at them from under a green eyeshade, a welcoming smile already forming on his lips. Then he saw the weapons in their hands and the masks over their faces.
"Oh my God!" he blurted.
Voker took immediate command.
"That's right, folks. This is a holdup. Everybody put your hands over your heads. You tellers fill money bags with everything in your tails. You, Mr. Banker."
He gestured with the muzzle of his Merwin and Hulbert revolver to the portly gentleman seated in a glass cubicle behind the teller's cages.
"You be so kind as to step over to the vault and empty it out."
Stammering, the banker refused to comply.
"You can't get away with this. The marshal will come running, and the sheriff is back in town. I'll not help you steal from these good people."
"In that case, we don't have any more use for you,"
Volker told him. Hub raised the Merwin and Hulbert, and it roared loudly in the confined space. Glass bulged inward and showered musically to the floor as the bullet passed through the dividing window and struck the banker in the forehead. He flew backward out of his padded horsehide swivel chair and crashed noisily against a file cabinet. 3 women customers began a chorus of shrieks and wails at the sight. Voker shoved through the swinging gate that divided the lobby from the working end of the bank and yanked a bug-eyed clerk from his desk. He shoved him toward the big safe.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.